Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back for the last session of the day, and in fact, the conference. Thank you for those brave souls still with us. For the rest of you tuning in virtually, thank you for joining us. The last panel is concerning real estate, obviously a very important and always revealing and entertaining topic, and leading the discussion, Dr. George Maltus, Managing Partner of Delphi and Partners Company, our main sponsor. Thank you, George. Looking forward to the discussion.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, guys. I mean, basically, we'll cover five topics of the real estate sector in Greece. It will be an interesting session. I'm sure you'll find it rather kind of detailed, because we have the experts of the market here. We have services, we have asset managers, we have real estate advisors, valuers, and so forth. So, I mean, let's kickstart. First of all, I would like to each panelists will introduce themselves. I'm George Mundis. I'm the managing partner of Delphi Partners and Co., a real estate asset management practice based in Greece, Athens. And obviously, Dimitri, do you want to say a couple of things?
Everybody, and thank you very much for the invitation. George, my name is Dimitris Andritos, and I'm the CEO of Tsepra Property Services here in Greece.
Thank you, Dimitris. I'm very happy to be among esteemed colleagues in this panel. My name is Chris Mantzouratos. I'm a director in the commercial advisory and underwriting segment of Arbitrage Real Estate, a boutique firm based in Athens. Dimitri.
Hello. First of all, I want to thank DDC about the summit, and also all of you, either virtual or in person, that you are still with us. I'm Dimitris Papakristou from Build Up Real Estate Development and Investment, and we are specialized in the technical and ownership due diligence and closing of contracts of real estate assets.
Lila. Good afternoon. Great to be here. Thank you for the invitation. I'm Lila Pateraki. I'm the Chief Real Estate Officer for Duvalu in Greece. Duvalu is one of the leading MPL and REO servicers in Europe, namely Spain, Italy, Portugal, Cyprus, and Greece.
Hello, my name is Nikita Zisimos. I'm the CEO of Valsvit, which is a Hippogis Iberia company. And I would like also to thank DDC for taking the initiative to do this first hybrid meeting after the conference after the COVID adventure.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, guys. So let me kickstart. I mean, the first kind of theme that I want to discuss, and maybe Dimitris, I will start with you, is that, tell us a bit, has the pandemic actually affected the real estate market? I mean, which asset classes and in which depth, if it has actually affected? Do you want to elaborate a bit on that?
For sure, pandemic was initially, let's say, a shock for the real estate market, and the first signs was were the frozen of the market. At the same time, I have to say that during this period, which is almost a year now, we didn't see any signs of prices reduction, but it was mainly a holding period, wait and see period. Mm-hmm. So the first that we can say now, after almost 2 years, is if I rephrase the question, is has the pandemic has gone? Okay, in order to see that and to answer that, it's good to compare, let's say, the third quarter of 2021 with the third quarter of 2020. For sure, it is a much better quarter, more active, much more transactions, much more players in the market, and increasing prices. But to be honest, I don't know if the pandemic has gone, because the effects of the pandemic are not only the healthy ones. What now we are saw with the high prices in energy, in transportation, all this. So we have things to see in front of us.
Yeah.
But what I expect is, and it's really important to see how this will affect the real estate finally, because if, but generally, the first 2 years shows quite, let's say, positive or optimistic signs than the initial very pessimistic that we were, so we believe.
Interesting. So, yeah. Lila, what do you think?
Yeah, I was going to say that we keep talking about how the pandemic has affected asset classes. Well, in reality, I think we should talk about how it has affected subsectors and what I mean by that. For example, hospitality. There is a huge discussion whether or not hospitality has been affected. Mm-hmm. And on the one hand, you have the, you know, all-inclusive, low-budget hotels that have definitely been affected by the pandemic, and we saw a decrease in revenues. We see a decrease in revenues on business hotels, because that's the first conference, at least, that I've seen people gathering around. Yeah. But more exclusive, you know, secluded, even small hotels. I'm not talking necessarily luxury hotels, but small hotels have attracted a lot of interest and have seen a lot of tourism. Mm-hmm. So within hospitality, you have subsectors, that's what I was talking about. You have subsectors that are affected and subsectors that are not. Retail is the same.
Yeah, true.
Definitely we've seen, and maybe not so much in Greece, we've seen that the huge human density sectors have been affected. Student housing, senior housing. Though we hear from abroad where these, you know, this market, this segment of the market is more active, that there is a huge sell-off, mm-hmm. and that people are very concerned. We don't have it that much in Greece, so we, you know, we're not familiar with that phenomenon. But I think, generally, we should concentrate on the niche of each asset class and decide whether or not, based on the flexibility that the pandemic has showed us that we need to have. I think that's the other lesson we learned, is that in order to survive, you need to adapt. Yeah. Whether those sectors were flexible enough in order to be able to cope with what has happened.
Interesting. Nikita, do you want to elaborate and add anything?
Yes, this was, you know, the COVID situation was a temporary parenthesis, you know, that freezed all the real estate transactions. And like, for example, last year, we were very worried about the impact in different categories of assets, like the hotel business. However, we see now in the summer that, you know, we had a V-shape comeback on the tourism that made, you know, the hotels again attractive, you know, to potential investors or as an asset class. So, as also Lila said, it's very important to see what are the effects in specific areas of each asset class. So, and also, as Dimitri says, we need to see the aftermath, you know, with the energy crisis, that it seems that it's ahead of us, and this might also create a new wave of turbulence in the whole market, real estate market. Yeah.
Christo, anything to add on that?
Well, I totally agree with all the concepts and the opinions said earlier, and about the hotels in terms of the niche type of product, the units that are more well-suited for to become branded hotels. We have seen demand on this side, and as well the residential component from the institutional investors that have been looking, due to the lack of kind of product, doing either residential developers or doing searching for this kind of quality of product.
I agree. Dimitris, do you want to add anything?
Yes, what I would like to add is that the COVID period started during the first period of the reopening of the real estate actually market. After a 10 years period of recession, the spiral was squeezed, so we were at the booming of the spiral, and that thing covered any problems that created by COVID. Mm-hmm. The biggest problem that happened to the real estate market because of COVID was the freeze of the transactions because of technical issues, because we couldn't have open authorities, we couldn't move. So that's what we faced more, the freeze and not be able to conclude to transactions.
I agree. Yeah. So the closing element of the transactions has been severely affected, especially the civil engine has been poorly running and performing in terms of, you know, transferability of the assets, and not, as Dimitri said, the extent, it wasn't huge of the pandemic. Some asset classes have been, yes, affected, but I fully agree with you. Let's move on to the next topic. I want to discuss technology, prop tech. Christos, do you want to elaborate a bit in which means has the technology in Greece, and we're not being theorists here, practically, has positively affected the underwriting or the monetization of REOs or real estate assets?
Yeah, well, technology in any sense is an enabler, meaning that helps us become more cost effective, have more efficient processes, and have a much more quicker analysis of all the data that is coming in large volumes. Mm-hmm. In any case, anything that has to do with underwriting and NPLs, and again, in REOs services, technology is essential. However, the human factor remains critical in a way that you need to do the calibration of the actual software. You need to be able to analyze and give a meaning on the data that the AVM or other solutions may provide. Securitizations that we have been working in the past, mega securitization, large securitization in the past, we have used as well from our experience, and we have seen AVM solutions with big data analytics and MI help us. Yeah. However, the human factor is of essence and needs to be there.
So it's complementary.
Yeah, and correct.
We cannot sell all the REOs that Lila has with a single website, right?
Yeah. Correct.
Dimitris.
Minimum, yes.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Okay. I totally agree. First of all, just don't confuse artificial intelligence with PropTech and that. Of course, this is an area that one wants to utilize more technology, AI technologies, and all that. We are at the beginning, at least in Greece. Just what I want to say is that we have started. I mean, as a country, as a market, we give more confidence to this. We invest at least the majority of the players, the key players in the market, including, of course, CPS. We invest a lot in what's called big data analytics to gather all the information needed. And finally, to have something concrete in our hands, because in the previous years, it was easy to easily, there's no data, we cannot do. No, the data always exists. Just in Greece, it was and remains, to be honest, difficult to gather data, to analyze the data, but as long as we invest in this, the outcome and the output is really good and promising, and we have started using this in our own analysis, I mean the market, and our life can be much, much easier, and we need that in order to speed up the whole process.
Just
to give you an example, I have 10 seconds. Years ago, not many years ago, 3-4 years ago, when you had, let's say, a portfolio of 2,000, 3,000 properties in front of you, it was a nightmare. How to analyze this and this and that. Now, we discuss about thousands and hundreds of thousands of properties, and portfolios, and these portfolios can be analyzed much, much easier. But of course, the human factor is the human factor.
Okay, Lila, what do you think?
Yeah, I was going to add to that, and we forget it, is that Greece is gradually moving away from the untransparency that existed in the real estate market. And as we start putting, and I'll use Cyprus for example, so as we start putting things in place, even digitization, simple things, digital land registry, digital urban plan offices, information on contracts, things that did not exist in this country, then we will be able to feed better data to the systems, apart from the human factor, I mean, of course, without saying, but even better data to the system. So, for example, in Cyprus, I know that, we were talking about AVMs and how they get data from actual transactions. It was a matter of just registering into the relevant, whatever, cadastral office and getting the information, something that we cannot do here yet.
Right now.
So I think the one thing that the pandemic has helped is the fact that it pushed forward the digitization of governmental, if you want, or of authorities, which means that gradually we'll start getting more and more information and we'll be able to use that information in order to be able to better value portfolios and also use you know, machines to value properties. Needless to say, and you know I'm a big fan of that, that property is unique, not properties are alike, which means that the human factor is extremely important. Otherwise, you will tend to go to make big mistakes.
Very true, very true. Thank you, Lila. Nikita, do you want to add on that?
I mean, I totally agree. I mean, PropTech has disrupt in a good way the real estate, you know, all over the world. So whoever does not invest in this or does not rely on this will be out of market eventually, because also the amount of assets that need to be processed, especially in this time of year that we have big transactions, we need, you know, this computing power in order to help the people. On the other hand, there are big sets of data in Greece that are still not digitized. And this needs to be, there are, of course, in the last years, there have been huge steps, you know, towards that sector. But in order to get more efficient on the machines and take out as much as manual work out of the whole equation, and in order to make it more efficient, we need the big set of data currently sitting in papers around Greece in different public authorities needs to be digitized. But yeah, for sure, it's an investment and it's the future, for sure.
Fully agree. Dimitri, do you want to add anything on that?
I would like to make a differentiation between technology needed for the marketing and the recording of the assets. That is something that already existed, and the most companies know it, how to record their assets and how to market them and to put them, to advertise them. And the need that it's in nowadays is the data collection for the maturity progress of the REOs. There is the big problem. We are cooperating with different services and banks of Greece, and according to the system of that they have of the data collection, of how they file their data that we are giving them from the authorities, and how they are monitoring the maturity progress of the REOs, this is the more effective part.
Interesting.
As efficient is their program and the technology, the more easier is our work.
Excellent. So to summarize, I think, yeah, the human factor is still there and plays a major role. Technology is supplementary currently in Greece, but it's evolving. We need to look at data integrity, data quality issues, because we might have data, but the integrity and the quality is not fantastic, and we need to work on that. But we all believe here, and if you disagree, please feel free to disagree. You know, the future, you know, asset managers, services, they need to invest in technology. So let's move on to the next one. It has to do with monetization of real estate assets, okay? Single sale assets versus bulk sale assets. And I want to start with you, Lila. You have a few thousands of collateral under management, and I'm sure this is a major thing that you think during your sleep in the evening, or not.
Well, we do have about 300,000 assets under management, so yeah, which are collaterals at this stage. I think that bulk sales or portfolio sales is also the way to go, not necessarily just because, you know, of what a servicer would like to do, but also what an investor would like to do behind the portfolio. So the investor would like to get some of the value up front. Of course, there will be, you know, there are different things. So on the one hand, you have a large number of assets that are though collaterals to loans, and we see that the services have more flexibility when compared to the banks in the past to be able to give solutions. So I believe that a lot of those assets will never reach, you know, the investors or the services or the market for that matter, because a lot of the loans will be structured and will be settled eventually. In terms of the REOs that exist, I think anyhow portfolio sales will be the future. As we start getting, don't forget that, for example, in Spain and in Portugal, where we have presence, we're no longer talking about NPLs, we're talking about portfolio or REO portfolio management. So all the loans are gradually turned into REOs. Whatever was able to be done was done. So now they were talking about REO management. So eventually this will happen here, so the stock will get bigger, but on the other hand, you will have solutions that will be able to be tailor-made to the needs of the investors. So you will be able to have, as the pool increases, you will be able to have more themed, let's say, portfolios rather than general portfolios that we have now with assets from various asset types.
I agree.
Or geographical location portfolios. But I think that's not a concern. There is a lot of money being raised for real estate globally. Sure. Yes, people will say, but that's mostly for investment and performing assets and not necessarily for NPLs or REOs. But on the other hand, real estate is becoming a main investment versus an alternative investment that it was back in the days.
True.
The spread on the yield between the interest rates, which are close to zero, and the yield a real estate property can bring is still very attractive. So I think that the real estate will become the main or the cornerstone of investment for a lot of investors in the future, and therefore, bulk sales will be something which will be normal.
Normal. Okay. Dimitri, CPS, what do you think?
You are Dimitri CPS now.
He's thinking bulk sales. He has a couple of projects, I think.
For me, first of all, it is one of the ways, but of course it's getting more and more attractive. More and more, potential investors are coming. So. Apart from the theoretical, and I totally agree with the description that and the analysis that Lila did, actually in practice, in the market now have much more players. They really want portfolios. Mm-hmm. And as long as we are ready to provide these portfolios, because we start with hundreds of thousands of properties, but finally how many of them are ready to be, let's say, part of a portfolio? Of course, there are some interesting ideas and schemes that we can do in order to have in the market even premature properties, and you are very well involved to schemes like that. Mm-hmm. But generally, as long as the properties are there, the investors are there, and of course, for REOs, it is, I believe that will be one of the main ways to dispose REOs. And of course, after that, because nobody can start selling piece by piece. Mm-hmm. But not forget that finally, all the investors need an end user. Okay, the bulk sales are good, but finally you need an end user. But it is the next step.
So you'll go from wholesale to retail eventually anyway.
Anyway.
Someone will do. So, Nikitas, do you want to elaborate on that?
Yes.
Quickly?
Yeah. Currently, as we are in the market in Greece, it's inevitable to go to big transactions, especially, some of them are on the market even right now, in order to get rid, let's say, of big chunks of assets that are currently available. So it's inevitable to go to big bulk sales. However, as you know, we are educated and the assets are maturing, we need to go to a more, as Lila said, the more, let's say, scientific approach in order not to overflow the market with assets. Yes. So there needs to be a careful selection in the future of type of assets or size of assets that needs to be disposed gradually in the market. So, eventually we have to pray, for Lila to sleep well at night in order to handle these 300 assets wisely, to go to the market in order not to oversaturate the market in a specific time period. So sure. We have to be also very careful on this.
Christos, quickly, you want to elaborate?
Well, very quickly, Lila, Dimitris and Lila, to be honest, they hit the nail on the head, that in a way that's what we see as providers as well. Thematic portfolios coming to the market, either sector-wise, geographical-wise, this is the near future.
Dimitri?
Yes, what I would like to add that bulk sale is a solution sometimes, like in all the products, for all the products, when we have bulk sales, we can put different type and quality of products inside. This is the same thing with assets. So it gives us the opportunity to put inside the portfolio that we form some problematic asset with some AAA assets, so we can get, under quotation, get rid of them at the same time. Yeah. This is an advantage of bulk sale for the services.
I fully agree, and just to add that I think the banks and services and institutional investors start thinking about clever structures, how to monetize unlegalized assets. And the issue here in bulk sales is the time to legalize, as we say technically, in the asset management sphere. So yeah, I believe it's a future, and I believe we'll see a lot of homogeneous and specific asset classes or geographically distributed bulk sales. So it's not a generic thing that we have some assets in Athens and Thessaloniki and the rest are scattered. So yeah, let's move on to the next one, and I'm sure you will find quite interesting, is public auctions, okay? Last year or 2 years ago, we were saying that the public auctions, 5%, less than 5% are actually completed. Nowadays, we have seen a pickup. And I want your opinion, guys, because I'm sure, especially Lila has thousands and thousands of assets going into auction. What's your view on that?
Well, when we started into value promoting assets at auctions, and I know it was done in the past, so don't get me wrong, but we started doing it a little bit more structured, or at least that's what I think, in terms of building a broker's network, but mainly explaining what an auction is. So they were always promoted, and my colleagues here were doing, long before I came along, the work for the auctions. I think what was missing, and also the government has helped in that, in terms of auctions becoming more transparent. So people were afraid of auctions. We used to have, you know, the physical presence and something that doesn't exist, so people were reluctant to go somewhere to bid for a house. We used, now there is a transparent process. The information provided for that asset was limited. Now, gradually, we start seeing that this is increasing. So we have the BALIF report. Now we can have the evaluation done. Mm-hmm. With the new law, you can have pictures. You can have the floor plans. You can have deeds. So gradually, we're making this a more, a closer to a... consensual sale agreement, a transaction, which means that the market is not afraid to touch it. And we see what we have seen, and we were very pleasantly surprised, was that we start seeing in the auctions a lot of, not necessarily the investors or the people that are more sophisticated, but people that are actually looking for a house in a specific, or an apartment specific location, and they cannot find it, whether through an auction they can. So this has, that's why I said, and we have an amazing result in terms of amount of assets that are sold through auctions. Of course, in a limited period of time, okay, we've only started in May, June, and we pretty much had it for 2 months, and now September, 3 months pretty much. So we'll see how the trend will evolve, but I think more and more people are realizing that because we had a stop in construction activity for a long period of time.
Always, forever.
A long period of time, now it's the time that people can find the assets they're looking for through the auction process.
It's great to have him here.
Thank you, nice to meet you all.
Martin, I think we can hear you talking.
Okay.
Sorry, Lila.
Yeah. So I think it's the future, and also for the brokers, if you want, or for the sales network, it's also a more, a less strenuous, let's say, effort, because it stops at auction.
Yeah.
Usually a transaction takes in Greece five, six, seven, 8 months.
True.
Yeah. So here is a
the closing is faster.
It's faster. It's easier, you know, you have, you know, whatever was sold and then you move on. Of course you have to do, and it's also the opportunity for all the people in the servicing sector, you know, all the, and I think we will start seeing it as well, all the services that can be offered to people that are buying from auctions that are right now afraid, okay, I've bought this house from auction, and then what? What do I have to do?
True.
I'm not informed. So this opens a whole new market, which is the services to be offered as after auction to anyone who wants to buy a house. So combination of, you know, promoting an asset and then selling and then offering the after auction service.
Nikita, have you seen a more institutional level of players buying through public auctions? What do you think?
Yes, in the beginning it was, but as you know, time goes by, auctions are coming more close to the single individuals. There were significant steps during you know, the last year in order to create this transparency in promotion and marketing of the asset. And I believe that there is room for improvement there, and also there is also a tendency of the people to be reluctant to go to the auction, that it's slowly, you know, is passing. So this will bring more people, you know, not to be afraid of the auction. This transparency that is ongoing, and also it's very, very important that currently the banks and the servicers, that they are putting the assets in auction, they pass a process before in order to make sure, as you know, as much as they can be, that the asset, the new owner, will not have any problem in the future when will buy the asset to the, in order to transfer it in the future.
So they do their pre-due diligence, let's put it.
Exactly. So the quality of the assets that that they are going now to auction, it's much more higher than it was, you know, a few years back. So we have seen there also a lot of effort to be done in order to democratize the process, not only to democratize the process to all people, to become, but also to improve the quality in order for the final buyer not to have any
and
problems.
Yeah, I agree. Christos, do you want to add on that?
Well, I agree, and basically my understanding and what we've seen is, can be summarized in three words that has been mentioned: system, process, and people. Meaning people do work out the systems and the processes in order for us to be able, anyone that is going to auction,
I agree,
have much more information as possible to get the bid.
Dimitri?
For me, if now we are in the process of changing the law, so in the auction phase, easily in an automated, let's say, way, in a maximum 100 days, we can see the prices to start reducing up to 65%. It is something that's happening almost all the European countries. We are the last that we have not that. If this finally be the case, I can tell you that this will be a game changer. Why? Because now many of the participants, okay, one party is, let's say, I don't want to participate in an auction for reasons, psychological or whatever. But one big part is that, okay, I'm going to an auction to acquire something in a market value, and I have not done any legal or technical diligence. I don't know what I'm buying. And I can tell you, first, of course, we have more information on that. I cannot tell you that it is, okay, it is better than before, but it's not, let's say, what really we want for a, let's say, for a transaction. Now, with these discounts that are going to take place, I can tell you that, yes, we're going to have really good opportunities, investment opportunities in auctions. And these price corrections, if I may use the expression, corrections meaning that through the price I can cover any other expenses that I may have, costs that I may have, in order to have a clear, let's say, property. These reductions in price, these discounts can over cover, in some cases, all the risk about that. So I can see really increase in participation in the auctions. We have increased participation till now, even now, from 2 to 3% to 15% to be, let's say, individuals. Individuals, I mean independent, no banks or whatever. So I predict that this figure will be increased. It will be a way in order to dispose properties and a very good source for opportunities, but mainly not for institutionals. It's really, at this moment, it's not that easy to form a portfolio. Of course, in some years, let's say, ahead, maybe we have this ability. But we'll increase the participation mainly of individuals or small, let's say,
portfolios. Investment arms. Dimitri?
Yes, what I would like to add to what I heard until now is that the biggest problem for auctions is the transparency. When they are... Can you hear me? When I am called to say if an asset is okay to be bought or not, the data available to me, to my company, from the private sector is 100%.
Yes.
To an auction does not come over the 30%. So I have a very big lack of data in order to say if the asset is okay or the potential buyer, bidder, will face problems or not.
Yeah.
So this is the biggest problem of the auctions. That's why in auctions we have so limited participation of individuals that they don't want to take these risks. The institutional bidders have counted this risk, like Dimitri said, that's why we see so many increasing the volume of REOs.
Yeah, I agree.
From my point of view, one solution will be to have a consensual agreement with the debtor before the auction in order to increase this data, in order to have more transparency regarding the asset that goes to an auction. This is not easy.
I think that would be very tough, to be fair.
This is not easy, but this is a way to increase people coming to auctions. And also to find a way, it's not at the moment to discuss that issue right now, to find a way to make the auction as a marketing instrument and not a for sale instrument.
Okay, yeah, but they have consensual sales as a different work stream, I think. But yeah, Lila, you want
to... yeah, just two things. One, we keep having in our mind that auctions are necessarily large assets with major problems. Auctions are also apartments, which, of course, they have illegalities, don't get me wrong, but they are more manageable, let's say, legalized, and easier to fix. And also the fact that the new law allows to fix quite a wide range of illegalities means that the asset, yes, you don't know and you might need to get some extra money, but as Dimitri said, this is part also that helps with the new law, which you will have a discount in value, which means that you can, you know, compensate for any assumed risk. But, you know, let's not just focus on assets that are not, for example, transferable, because they are, and majority of them and the ones that we see are assets that it's not such huge thing to fix. And the other thing that I think will make a huge impact on auctions is if we manage through banks to get financing.
True.
Because then that will make it very easy for a lot of people that cannot afford to do it, with equity, to participate in auctions.
And I think this is one of the biggest obstacles we have versus the REOs. And just to add on the whole thing is transparency, and you mentioned very correctly. I mean, we need to translate the website into English eventually, okay, two. And three, I believe, and I sincerely believe, that the way forward is to sell assets via the auction. Okay, maybe not all the assets will go to auction, but I think asset managers and services have a major role to play, post-acquisition through the auction. So you have evictions, you have legalizations, and you have all sorts of, you know, the asset management life cycle post-acquisition. That has to do with retail investors, semi-institutional or institutional investors. Excellent. If you don't have anything else...
I want to add something. I fully agree that if it's available finance to for assets through auctions, that will be a big force at the market. In order to have finance through banks for auctions, we have to have more transparent assets, because the person that gives the money,
they want to know what they're buying.
The bank or any institution needs to know exactly the situation of the asset. So as much transparency we have, as much the possibility to be financed will be increased.
Very true.
It's not only the transparency of the property. Generally, it's the whole structure, because you have another 100 days where the ex-owner can, let's say, pose or generally alter the decision and blah, blah, blah.
The auction,
so there are more things to be done. For me, it is important, everybody understands that we have several tools, several weapons with us. We have amicable solutions, we have auctions. It is important each one of these to be used in the best way, in order all of them together to give the best result. We cannot stand only to one, let's say, alternative.
I didn't want to make it more difficult saying about legal actions that the former owner could do after the auction. That's why I didn't mention anything about that.
But let's not get into that, because it's a whole different chapter.
Okay?
So let's move on to the next topic, which I'm sure you'll find rather interesting. And you know, there is this discussion now about the government, based on the new insolvency law, that they want to do this real estate, let's say, fund, that essentially they want to acquire residential primary residences and lease them back to the borrowers, funded by investors. And I want to start with you, Lila. I know we were in a government call and all the panelists here a week ago almost. Tell us what you think. Is it viable? The framework is not there yet 100%, okay? So we want to know your opinion, what you think about this tool, if I may call it.
Well, it's definitely one solution, because it gives a solution out of the vulnerable individuals that, you know, can continue living in houses. So it gives a solution to both the debtor, the services or the banks or the investors that have bought. So it sort of combines everything. The viability of the scheme depends on the final details of how it will come out, something we don't know yet.
Yes.
So there are a lot of question marks. My microphone does not want to stay in place. So there's a lot of question marks to be answered, which we will see once the tender is out.
Yeah.
I think there is a potential there, and we definitely are talking to investors that are interested in further looking into it and participating, subject of course, as I said, to the final tender that will come out. But I think it provides, as I said, I think it provides a good solution. So that's why I think it will be something that will attract interest, and we see that already.
What about the low returns that they were saying at the call? Do you think...
Well, the devil is in the detail. That's why I said it depends in the end what will be allowed to do, what costs we will have. Definitely needs a lot of asset management. So that's an asset management intensive project.
Yeah.
But I don't know... The returns can be adjusted based on the assumptions that will be used, or on the allowance, on the laws that will be combined with the SAT scheme. As long as we don't know them, I think it's premature to comment on them.
Dimitris Zervet, do you want to elaborate on that?
If I may use the same question, is it a game changer? No, I don't think that it will be a game changer to the whole market, but of course it's another tool. I totally agree with Lila, we don't know the details. Of course, it can be, let's say, attractive to investors based on specific assumptions. Mm-hmm. At the same time, I think that there are quite more things that needs to be, let's say, discussed and analyzed better and to be understood better. Just to give an idea, we say that from the auction side, we have a new law. We start with 100%, after 40 days in to 80%, and after 30 days, let's say, more or less, in 65%. And before an auction, this real estate fund can be, let's say, in the picture. At which price? According to the law, or at the market price? Yes, but after one or two or three, let's say, auctions, what should be the price? Okay, let's start from the beginning. So there are some details, but as a tool and as a mechanism, I believe it's something will be very useful.
Yeah.
And will give alternatives and an exit to some situations that now are really blocked.
Christo, do you want to quickly elaborate on that?
Well, I agree with all the things that has been said. I mean, there are many question marks, not how this mechanism will work. However, it is on the direction that we are trying to find solutions and keep the machine working. For instance, in this case, what we've read is like in 12 years' time after the debtor pays the rent, you need to have a value on the property and how you're going to price the property 12 years down the road. So there are questions that, again, we need to see how it works.
And what are the tax implications?
You
pay net or gross rent? Anyway, there are all sorts of stuff. But Dimitri, do you want to elaborate a bit on that? Or
actually, I cannot say anything because we were speaking with assumptions. We don't know. It's a tool with very good intentions.
I'm fully
from the part of the government, but it's like asking me if I would like a chocolate cake without knowing the intelligence of the cake and the final taste. So I cannot say anything
but
right
chocolate
now.
Chocolate cake, I'm sure you like.
Chocolate cake is always good.
Nikita, do you want to say anything?
That's why I use the chocolate cake. But in order to say, yes, it's good, I have to know more details about it.
As you know, everybody said, it's too premature, you know, to judge on this, but for sure it's a very useful tool. It's another tool in order to prevent, in many cases, you know, evictions, and to give another opportunity to low-income borrowers to retain their property. So, but there are a lot, you know, to be discussed, and also there is a delicate balance there in terms of entrepreneurship in the specific project and social responsibility that needs to be
it's a political thing as well, so
exactly.
we need to wait and see about that.
Yep.
So let's move to our final topic, which is asset management type of managing assets, in-source, in-house management and outsourcing. And I think let's start with our services because they're using a hybrid kind of model, maybe. And maybe you want to elaborate, which you believe is the most effective to manage more than half a million worth of REOs in the sphere soon?
Well, isn't always, you know, the better way somewhere in the middle. So I think it's, I think the pandemic brought that. We should, and we are changing the way we look at assets. Up until very recently, it was, let's acquire the assets, let's get the REO, we do nothing, and we just sell it. Or we do minimal, and we just sell it. The pandemic as well, and the climate change, has showed that that's no longer viable. We need to work on the assets. So you need to have a view and a hands-on on what your portfolio is, what its potential is, and how you can bring value and increase value in the end, and not value only through macro real estate, you know, increase in prices, capital appreciation. In order to do that, you need to have the in-house personnel that will understand, will know, will compare portfolios, will see synergies, will be able to combine strategies and produce the best result. Definitely, unless you want to have a very big and bureaucratic organization, you cannot do all that internally. Mm-hmm. So definitely you need to outsource services. You need to keep the grasp on the market. So the insourcing also has the risk of losing the direct relationship with the market. So it's very important to keep that relationship with the market, and that is done only through outsourcing and through the service providers. So, but as I said, I think it's very important that you have a team inside that validates, checks, follows up, manages the portfolio on its own as an asset manager. That's the proper way. And then the services to be done and the work to be done to be outsourced to third parties.
Interesting. Dimitri, CPMP.
For sure, first of all, I can play the role of outsourcer. So for me, it's easy to say everything should be outsourced, but there should be a balance. It is important to have, let's say, a very good understanding of what is happening in the market. And so you need also to have, in some cases, your own team in order to monitor the market, but also a very good, let's say, external collaborators to outsource. But for sure, outsourcing is a must, not only to this kind of, let's say, companies, but to everybody, because you know that you have ups and downs. Yeah. So in order to minimize all these...
financial risks.
Exactly. Yeah. Financially, you need to have spread out. But the most important also is that it should be a really huge if you want to have internally.
Yeah. Yeah. So big teams, you need, an army
exactly,
of people.
Yeah. It is important, just it is important to be more in cooperation, all of us, with, let's say, the services and the outsourcers in order to have the standard, to set the standards of the services.
The service
because for
quality
me,
levels.
This is the most important.
The consistency.
Exactly. Yeah. So if you have the standards, if you have a common language, then it is really easy to have a very good cooperation with the services.
Nikita?
This is, you know, the outsourcing or insourcing, you know, these services is the million-dollar question for us. So we are trying to find the balance between the two. Of course, the combination is, you know, is the answer. In which rate the combination will be, it's also on the DNA of the REO servicer that is doing, you know, this work. But definitely, in order to do that, you need for sure to have one IT system that can support, you know, throughout all your network of outsourcers to be able to gather the information in-house. You have to have for sure a very reliable and reporting tool in order to provide the necessary information of where in each stage each asset is.
In the life cycle.
Yes. And of course, you have to have in-house a group of experts, both in technical and legal part, in order to monitor, you know, the whole process. So, and of course, you have to have trusted partners throughout the Greece, to, you know, to go to search these big data sets that we said that they need to be digitized. Currently, they are not. So you have to have also physical presence with some trusted partners in all over Greece in order to be able to gather, you know, documentation fast and efficient.
True. Dimitris.
Yes, I will speak as a outsource company cooperating with the services and other companies. So as a subcontractor, and what can I say is that, of course, the majority must be outsourced, but we cannot work if the company does not have an in-house team. The in-house team is the heart that supports us. So, and this team, if it should be big or small, it depends to the reliability of the partners and the cooperation. If the partners are reliable, the in-house team can be decreased. If they are not and they need to be checked and double-checked, this team must be bigger. And also, the cherry-picking of the assets that they are going outsource must be done from inside, from in-house the companies. Cannot be done from anyone else.
True. Christos, thank you very much, Dimitris.
I think we all agree it's a combination. It's a mix of outsourcing and in-house management, with the in-house management team being a more high level and a strategy execution focused, and the having trusted providers to do all the servicing in this granular and manual work.
Agreed. Okay. Well, guys, thank you very much. all the panelists. It has been a genuine pleasure. I mean, we have another five minutes or so. Do you want to ask any questions? The audience, they're here to answer any type of questions you have, almost any type. I'm sure you're tired and you all want to go. So thank you very much again, guys. It has been a genuine pleasure. Thank you, DDC, for the lovely conference. And I'm sure we'll do a lot more in the coming months. And hopefully these guys will be able to come again at the conference and speak about the progress that we have made since the last conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you.